Good day, everyone. This is Dr. Soper here, and today I'll be presenting the second of three lessons about the fundamentals of the Python programming language. The information presented in this video builds upon the knowledge and skills that were developed in the previous lesson, so if you haven't already done so, I would highly recommend that you watch the previous video in this series prior to beginning this lesson on Python. To begin, let's briefly review what you'll learn in this lesson. By the time you have finished this video, you will know about the following aspects of Python: lists, NumPy arrays, if statements, and logical operators. Along the way, we'll see illustrative examples and demonstrations of all of these features of the Python programming language. We'll begin this lesson by discussing lists in Python. A list is simply a named collection of items. The items in a Python list can be anything: numbers, text, variables, objects, and even other lists. Note that a list whose items are other lists is called a multidimensional list. In this first example, we're declaring a list named intList, and are setting the values of its elements to -3, 7, 4, 0, -2, and 342. If it helps, you can think of a simple one-dimensional list like this as a vector. Python knows that this is a list because of the square brackets. We are setting the values of the elements in the list by placing a comma-separated list of values inside the square brackets. Again, lists can contain items of any data type. In the second example, we're declaring a list of planets and setting the list's elements to the names of all of the known planets in our solar system. Note that the International Astronomical Union demoted Pluto to the status of a dwarf planet in 2006, which is why it is not included here. In this third example, we're declaring a two-dimensional list, that is, a list whose elements are also lists. If it helps, you can think of this as a 2x3 matrix with two rows and three columns. Let's see a few demonstrations of lists being declared and used in Python. In this first code cell, we're simply declaring the three lists that we just discussed. When we run this cell, no output will appear on the screen, because all that we're doing here is telling Python to create these three lists and store them in the computer's memory. In the next code cell, we'll see how to access the values of specific items in a list, but before we can do that, we'll need to understand indexing in Python. In brief, Python uses a zero-based indexing system. This means that whenever we have a collection like a list or an array, the first item in the list will have an index of 0, the second item will have an index of 1, and so on. Using our intList as an example, the list contains 6 values. Thus, if we want to access, say, the value of the 5th item in the list, that item would have an index of 4. With this zero-based indexing system in mind, the next code cell simply prints the name of the 3rd planet in the planets list to the screen, which, in this case, is Earth, and as the 3rd list element, should be located at index position 2. Let's click the Run button to verify that the results are as expected, and that the Earth is indeed the 3rd rock from the Sun. Our next topic in this lesson is NumPy arrays in Python. NumPy, or Numeric Python, is a library that adds support for multidimensional arrays, matrices, and high-level mathematical functions to Python. NumPy arrays are a lot like lists, except with lots of additional features and capabilities. Since NumPy is a library, we first need to import NumPy into our current project in order to be able to use it. The typical way of importing NumPy is shown here. Note that the as syntax establishes an alias. In this case, we're telling Python that we want to import NumPy and that we want to be able to refer to it in our code as np. In this example, we're creating a two-dimensional NumPy array of size 2x3, that is, 2 rows and 3 columns, and are using the NumPy zeros function to set the values of all of the items in the array to 0. These next two lines of code set the values of the upper left and lower right elements in the array to 5 and 3, respectively. Finally, this last line of code demonstrates one of the many cool features of NumPy. Here we're using NumPy's mean function to automatically calculate the average of all of the elements in the array. NumPy has many similar functions, such as min, max, median, etc., that can be very useful when working with numeric data. Let's see a few examples of NumPy being used in Python. In this first code cell, we import NumPy into the project and assign it an alias of np. We then create a two-dimensional array of size 2x3, that is, 2 rows and 3 columns, and set all of its values to 0 by using the NumPy zeros function. Finally, we print the current state of the two-dimensional NumPy array to the screen. Let's run our code and see what happens. As you can see, our NumPy array currently consists of 2 rows and 3 columns, and all of the values in the array are 0. Next, let's briefly discuss indexing in Python when we're working with two-dimensional lists and arrays. In brief, in order to access an element in a two-dimensional list or array, we need to specify the index of both the element's row and the index of its column, in that order. Just as with lists, these indexes are zero-based. As such, the indexes for the element in the upper left corner of our two-dimensional array would be 0, 0, while the element in the lower right corner of the array would have indexes of 1, 2. In our next code cell, we begin by setting the values of the upper left and lower right elements in the array to 5 and 3, respectively. We then print the current state of the array so that we can see that the values have indeed been changed. Finally, we use the NumPy mean function to compute the average of all of the elements in the array. Let's run the code cell and see what happens. As expected, the upper left and lower right elements in the two-dimensional NumPy array were set to 5 and 3, respectively, and the mean of all of the values in the array was calculated to be 1.333. If we were to manually calculate the mean, we would note that the sum of all of the values in the array is 8. And since there are 6 elements in the array, the average would be 8 divided by 6, which of course is 1.333. Next, let's learn about if statements in Python. If statements are very useful because they give us the ability to do different things depending on whether a condition is true or false. In this first example, we begin by declaring a variable named x and setting its value to 10. We then use an if-else structure to print a specific message depending on whether x is less than 10. The first line of code begins with the keyword if, followed by the condition that we want to evaluate, and then a colon. Note that the next line is indented. Any indented lines appearing after the if statement will be run if the condition in the if statement is true. Thus, in this example, if the value of x is less than 10, Python will print x is less than 10 to the screen. The next line of code begins with else, followed by a colon. Here we're telling Python that we want it to do something else if the condition in the if statement is not true. In this case, if the value of x is not less than 10, then it must be greater than or equal to 10. As such, Python will print x is greater than or equal to 10 if x is not less than 10. We can extend this if-else structure to handle multiple possibilities by using an if-else-if-else structure. In this example, we begin by declaring an age variable and setting its value. We then use an if-else-if-else structure to determine if a person is a child, teenager, or adult based on the person's age. We first check if the person's age is less than 13. If so, then we know that the person is a child. If not, then we next check if the person's age is less than 20. If so, then we know that the person's age is between 13 and 19, and that the person is hence a teenager. If not, then we know that the person must be 20 or older, which in this example makes the person an adult. Let's see demonstrations of these various if statements in our Jupyter notebook. In this first code cell, we declare a variable named x and set its value. We then use an if-else structure to print a specific message depending on whether x is less than 10. Let's run the code cell and see what happens. Since the value of x is currently 10, Python prints x is greater than or equal to 10 to the screen. If we change the value of x to, say, negative 7, and then run the code cell again, we should get a different result. After changing the value of x to negative 7, Python now prints x is less than 10. This next code cell implements the if-else-if-else structure that we discussed a few moments ago in order to determine if a person is a child, teenager, or adult based on the person's age. Let's run the cell and see what happens. As expected, Python prints child because the value of the age variable is currently set to 5. If we change the value of age and then rerun the code cell, we will get different results. As you can see, different results are generated depending on the person's age. Next, we'll learn about logical operators in Python. Python provides us with three logical operators: AND, OR, and NOT. Logical operators are very useful because they allow us to test multiple conditions simultaneously. This first example shows how we can use the AND and OR logical operators to determine if two variables are positive. The if statement checks to see if x is positive and y is positive. If so, both variables are positive as printed to the screen. If both variables are not positive, then the else-if statement will next check to see if x is positive or y is positive. If so, one of the variables is positive is printed to the screen. If neither x nor y is positive, then the else statement will run and neither variable is positive will be printed to the screen. This next example shows how the NOT logical operator can be used to reverse or invert the result of a comparison. We begin by declaring a variable named age and setting its value to 7. The if statement then checks whether the person's age is not less than 13. It does this by first evaluating whether age is less than 13, and then applying the NOT operator to reverse the result of that evaluation. Thus, if a person is not less than 13, then the person must be at least 13 years old, and hence is not a child. Otherwise, the person must be less than 13, and is hence a child. Let's see a few demonstrations of these logical operators being used in Python. This first code cell demonstrates the use of the AND and OR logical operators to determine if two variables, x and y, are positive. The if statement checks if x is positive and if y is positive. If at least one of these conditions is false, then the entire statement will evaluate to false, and Python will proceed to the else-if statement. The else-if statement evaluates if either x or y is positive. If neither of these conditions is true, then Python will proceed to the else statement. Let's run the code cell and see what happens. Since x and y are currently equal to 5 and 10 respectively, Python prints both variables are positive as expected. If we change the values of x and y and then rerun the code cell, we will see different results. Our next code cell demonstrates the use of the NOT logical operator to reverse the result of a comparison. We begin with the value of the age variable set to 7. The if statement then checks to see if the person is not less than 13. If the person is less than 13, then this statement will evaluate to false. in which case Python will proceed to the else statement. Let's see what happens when we run this cell using different values of age. As expected, when the age is greater than or equal to 13, Python prints "the person is not a child" to the screen. Otherwise, Python prints "the person is a child." In this lesson, we learned about how to use lists, NumPy arrays, if statements, and logical operators in Python. I hope you'll join me for the next video in this series, in which we'll build upon your new skills by learning how to create and use for loops, while loops, functions, classes, and objects in Python. Well, my friends, thus ends our second lesson on the fundamentals of the Python programming language. I hope that you learned something interesting in this lesson, and until next time, have a great day.